Have you ever had to have a tooth extracted? The procedure is simple. You go to the dentist, get a referral for an x-ray, return to the dentist with the image, and after 15 minutes to 6 hours of sheer pleasure, you're done. Long story short, it's great fun, isn't it? But speaking of the x-ray, have you ever wondered how it's possible that this machine can see your teeth clearly through the skin and muscles of your face? Never? Me neither. But it's time to change it. Here's a video about x-ray. Let's start with what x-ray really is and why it has such a strange name. Well, in the late 19th century, Wilhelm Röntgen discovered a new kind of radiation. What was special about it was that it could pass through many different materials. It turned out to be a breakthrough discovery. But this new radiation was mysterious and incomprehensible, so it was given the name X, which in mathematics usually refers to something unknown. Now let's move on to a more difficult question, that is, what did Röntgen actually discover? I could just say it's an electromagnetic wave with high frequency and energy, but I guess that wouldn't tell you anything. In fact, this topic is more complicated than it seems, so I will have to use many simplifications. Let's start with a short riddle. What do the radio and our eye have in common? Well, their work is based on receiving a kind of waves which we will call electromagnetic waves. These waves have an important parameter, the wavelength. Some waves have wavelengths that can be used in telecommunications so we can talk on the phone, or in transmitting sounds and images so we can listen to the radio and watch TV. Waves within this wavelength range are generally called radio waves. They're invisible for a human eye, but we can clearly see their effects in our daily life. However, there are waves that are shorter than the radio waves, for example visible light. These are the waves that our eyes can see. They are emitted by fire, light bulbs, or the screen you are now looking at. But what about waves that are even shorter than these? Our eye is sensitive only to a small part of electromagnetic wave spectrum. Beyond a certain boundary, there is a range of radiation invisible for us, which we will discuss in this video. Of course, these are not all the kinds of electromagnetic waves, but we won't focus on others here. The important things are that the shorter the wave, the higher the energy, and that each electromagnetic wave is made of single, indivisible portions of energy called photons, which I will draw as small balls for simplicity. A good example that will help us understand it is money. The smallest portion of money is a cent. It is indivisible, we can't pay half or quarter of a cent. In the same way, photon is the smallest portion of energy of an electromagnetic wave. Okay, but why was the discovery of these rays so important? Well, because they can be used to look inside a person without a scalpel. The development of radiology has been a great help for doctors in assessing bone fractures, preparing patients to surgeries, early diagnosis of dangerous cancers, and many other areas. But how does radiation produce an image of the inside of your body? Everything starts with an X-ray tube. An X-ray tube is made up of several key elements. Let's begin with the cathode. Usually it's a tungsten wire coil through which the current flows. This flow heats the cathode up. In the microscopic scale, it means that tungsten atoms have more and more energy. As a result, some electrons are discharged, and a so-called electron cloud forms around the cathode. In physics, this phenomenon is called thermionic emission. But we don't want the electrons to fly disorderly all around the tube, so we need to somehow get them together. Therefore, a focusing cap is placed around the cathode. It is responsible for focusing the electron beam in the smallest area possible. What happens next? In the next stage, the high voltage source produces electric field which pushes the electrons emitted from the cathode toward the anode. We could compare it to a steep slide, but in the case of electrons, The slide will not end with a soft landing. The electrons hit the anode at a high speed. As a result, about 99% of energy is converted into heat, and about 1% into X-rays, which we need. It is really kind of the 1% not to follow the crowd, but why does it behave in a different way? The answer lies in breaking radiation and the production of characteristic X-rays. Sounds interesting, but what does it mean? I won't go into details now, but if you would like to learn something more about it, please see the references in the description. Now I will only discuss these two phenomena briefly. In the first case, the X-ray is emitted because electrons coming near the nucleus are attracted by it, which deflects their path. Like a vehicle slows down before turning, electrons that change the direction also need to slow down. While braking, the vehicle releases its energy in the form of heat. The temperature of brake pads, discs, and tires grows. And how do electrons release their energy? In the form of X-rays. Another way of X-ray emission is characteristic radiation. Like a billiard ball, an electron collides with another electron from the anode and ejects it. This creates a vacancy, so other electrons are very happy to fill the space instantly. As the new electron takes the place of the one that used to be there, energy is also released, and yes, also in the form of X-rays. But let's get back to the anode. Because it is constantly hit by electrons, its surface temperature can reach over 2000 degrees Celsius. That is why the anode is made of materials with high melting temperature, for example tungsten or rhenium, and materials that can efficiently carry away heat, such as copper or molybdenum. The first X-ray machines had fixed anodes. Unfortunately, this caused some problems. Why? The area where the electrons strike the anode is called the focal spot. When a smaller focal spot was used, the obtained image was clearer, but also higher temperature was generated at a particular point, which often resulted in the anode melting. This is not a problem in the case of images of small organs because the anode does not have the time to overheat. But what about images that require more electrical power and time? Should we enlarge the focal spot so the image will be of a poorer quality, but at least we'll have any? The problem of overheating can be solved with a rotating anode. It is a disc settled on an axis. The anode has a tungsten ring that electrons strike. As the tube works, the anode powered by an electric motor rotates even several thousand times a minute. This way, we avoid heating up particular spots, like in the case of the fixed anode, so we can increase the power and duration of the machine's work. Of course, both types of anode are used in medicine nowadays. The fixed anode is used, for example, in examining teeth, hands, or feet. The rotating anode is used for imaging bigger and thicker structures, for example, the chest or the spine. Although we've mentioned most elements of the X-ray tube, there are also a few others necessary for its work. The whole process takes place in a glass envelope from which practically all air has been removed. The vacuum in the tube is crucial because we would like all the accelerating electrons to reach the anode, not to lose their energy when bumping into gas particles. As a result of such collisions, electrons would run everywhere within the tube instead of going straight to the anode. There are other elements too. Around the glass envelope there is a housing filled with oil which carries away heat from the anode and cools it down. This allows longer work of the tube and makes it more durable. Believe me, we really wouldn't like X-rays to reach out of the examined area, for example other organs or the doctor. Why? Because X-rays are ionizing. Well, okay, but what does it mean? You see, a single photon of X-ray that hits an atom of a chemical element has enough energy to free electrons from that atom. Then, the removed electron can collide into other nuclei, and so on and on. It happens until it loses the whole energy of the photon that started the play. Why is it a problem? Well, when some inanimate objects, such as the table on which the patient is lying, or the walls of the room are irradiated, nothing serious happens. The doses are so small that the chaos they cause is quickly fixed. But in the case of human cells, the situation is completely different. As the photons of X-ray hit the human body, they can remove electrons from atoms that make our cells. This produces free radicals. Of course, the organism has some mechanisms to fix the ionized DNA or another element of our cells, but they are not perfect. And sadly, many studies show that even the smallest doses of radiation increase the probability of dangerous cancers developing years later. This is why you can only get an X-ray for a specific purpose and with a referral from your physician. Also, the doses of radiation are limited. However, we shouldn't go into extremes. In fact, every day we are exposed to ionizing radiation, for example from radioactive isotopes that occur on the Earth or from the space. For a proper perspective, let's see a few examples. One tooth X-ray equals an average daily dose a human takes in just because of living on the Earth, and it is 6 times less than the radiation absorbed during a transatlantic flight. And a neck X-ray equals about 18 daily doses and 3 transatlantic flights. And did you know that there is something like a banana equivalent dose? I was surprised too when I learned it. It's the amount of radiation equivalent to the amount that we theoretically take in when we eat a banana. For example, the deadly dose of radiation corresponds to eating 100 million bananas, while having a tooth X-ray corresponds to 50 bananas. To sum up, it's good to keep raising our awareness about ionizing radiation, but it's also good to remember that a method of treatment that is 100% safe and has no complications or side effects does not exist. Because X-rays are not neutral for our health, it is of key importance to protect the medical personnel and the patient. How? In the case of medical personnel, there are 3 main means of protection. The first one is the attenuation properties of an X-ray tube. Unfortunately, although in theory everything looks great, the X-ray beam obediently leaves the tube and reaches the patient. In fact, part of the rays are emitted in other directions, but before they reach the doctor, they meet the glass, oil, and lead that covers the housing. This complex shield effectively weakens the beam. Another means of protection is the aprons and gloves made of materials that absorb the radiation. But still, the most important and simplest way of protection is the distance. It is assumed the doctor should stay at least 2 meters away from the tube during the examination. But it does not mean he or she has to sit on the other side of the building. And what about protecting the patient? After all, as part of the examination, the patient has to absorb a certain dose of radiation. It's true, but there is something that can increase their safety too. First, we can narrow the beam so as to irradiate only the area that needs to be examined. Various slits and more advanced devices called collimators are used for this purpose. Filtration is another important thing. You see, out of all the wavelengths of X-ray, some are very useful, for example, in mammography, but useless in the examination of the spine, and the other way around. Therefore, from the entire emitted beam, we would like to keep only those wavelengths that will produce an image. Otherwise, the patient would receive an additional unnecessary dose. But how to filter out the part of radiation that does not produce an image? The waves that are too long are cut off using the window in the glass tube, which may be made of, for example, lead and absorbs the long waves we don't want, but allows shorter waves to pass through. And how to get rid of the short waves? They are cut off by reducing the power of the device, and that's how the patient only receives the dose needed to produce an image. Okay, let's move on, because to get an image we need something more than just a source of X-ray. Although X-ray images are taken in different positions, now we can focus on pictures taken while the patient is lying. In this situation, a cassette is placed directly under the patient. Among other things, it contains the film on which the image is produced. But how is it possible that we can see anything on the film? The photons that leave the X-ray tube but are not absorbed by the patient's tissue fall in the film and make it black. Different tissues absorb rays to different extent. This makes a so-called 5-degree radio density scale, which shows which tissues absorb radiation to what extent, and consequently, which ones will be darker and brighter on the film. Air is the darkest. The next one is fat, followed by liquids and soft tissues. Then calcium, which is an important component of bones, and finally metal, which is the whitest on the film. So as we can see in the example image, bones are most visible, but by giving special contrasting agents to the patient, we can also see clearly the structures that would otherwise be hardly visible, for example kidneys or veins. But let's get back for a moment to the way of recording the image, because a picture recorded directly on the film very often looks really foggy. This is because of Compton effect. Sometimes, instead of being absorbed or just flying through the body, a rebellious photon collides into an electron and ejects it. Afterwards, the photon turns and hits the film where it should not. As a result, the film is slightly blackened in random places. It may be very misleading for the physician looking at an X-ray image. So how to get rid of the beam that causes blur? We can use anti-scatter grids. Their task is to let through only the photons that fall in the original beam's direction and stop the ones that fly somewhere else. They are like border guards for photons, guarding access to the film. It's interesting that although the anti-scatter grids are often used, actually they weaken the X-ray beam very much, so the dose needs to be increased to obtain a clear image. Therefore, sometimes they are not used at all, and a lower quality of image is accepted. Thanks to this, the picture can be taken with a smaller dose of radiation, for example in the case of children or pregnant women. Although I've said before that the image is directly recorded on the film, in fact this process is more complex. Various intensifying screens are often used, or the analog methods are discarded altogether in favor of digital technology. This way, we don't need to produce the film and the doctor can see the results on the computer screen, which allows quick comparison of images and information transfer between hospitals, and AI can train, for example, early diagnosis of cancers. Although this approach is very expensive and is only developing in some countries, it seems to be the future of radiology. Okay, this was just a small fragment of knowledge about the use of radiation in medicine. For do you know that X-ray can be used to watch the blood flow in veins in real time, make 3D images of our organs, or treat cancers? Well, these are subjects for other videos, but if you'd like to learn about them, please let me know in the comment. If you want to support my channel, please see the description. Finally, I would like to tell you that if you are a student and feel that a huge roller called mathematics or physics is chasing you, I invite you to my private online classes. You can find all the info in the description. Thank you for watching.